in Jackson, Tennessee. Well, we're delighted to have this young lady with us. She was scheduled over in the next hour. She's been flying in from Europe. So you got the jet lag and everything else, right?
Yeah, well, it's okay. It's okay. I'm fine.
Okay, good.
Thank you.
All right. Lana Wolf is with us. She is out of the Netherlands. She's recorded in Nashville, Tennessee at Studio 19.
Yeah.
What caused you to come to Nashville to record? You'd done it before, right?
Yeah, I've done it before. I think it was 4 years ago that I recorded my first album. Well, it was a dream of mine just to come to Nashville and play with all those musicians they have here in Nashville and Tennessee. So I thought, well, how am I going to make that happen? So I just called around, and I ended up at Studio 19.
19, okay.
At one of the best studios in Nashville.
That's exactly
yeah,
right.
I was lucky because
so
it
you
was
didn't
just
really
a long
know.
Shot.
You just kinda, so you just kind of called up and said, hey, where should I record? And
yeah.
I said, Studio 19.
Yeah.
Is that when you met Larry the first time?
Yeah, the first time, and then we went to lunch, and we had a connection, a musical connection, because now I stay at his place all the time, and we listen to YouTubes and music for hours and hours on the kitchen table. It's so much fun, you know. He's just like my other father, and a musical father, you know. It's just so great to be here, and everything around here is about music, and that's what I love about Tennessee, you know.
Well, Lana Wolf is with us. She is from the Netherlands. She's visiting in Jackson, Tennessee. It's a brand-new album out. And we're putting it on display here. I'll hold it up, get it back in camera view here with Paul. But it's Fireflies in Nashville, and it was done. Was all of it done at Studio 19, or some of this done at your? All this done in Nashville. Fireflies in Nashville at Studio 19, and we've been playing "Love Being a 70s Child." We got another song we're gonna play right now. It's called "Ball and Chain." Tell me about this song.
Well, "Ball and Chain" is just about a bad man, a bad boyfriend. I hope I don't have to explain it.
Okay. So it speaks for itself.
Yeah, it does.
Okay. Love Being a 70s Child is what we've been playing. She is with us in the studio. Well, not in the studio. Right here at the Dixie Cafe in the Old Country Store, Casey Jones Village, Jackson, Tennessee. If you want to come by and see us, you can. And if you stop by and see us and talk to Lana, we got a $10 gift card to the Outback. Right, Tim? That gets you 10 bucks worth of stuff at the Outback today. Okay. Oh, I got two. $30 worth of stuff for the Outback. Two cards, one for 20 and one for 10. So you come by and see us. Say, we heard you talking about it. We got some. Plus, you want to meet Lana anyway. Sometimes I'll say Lana because we have a Lana area here in our city.
I know. Lana. Sometimes Lena, in Nashville, yeah, I'm Lana. Lana sometimes Lana. Lana.
Yeah,
I listen to every name.
Lana.
I don't
care. But Lana. But Lana. Yeah, we say Lana. Lana. And so there you are. Anyway, we're glad to have you here.
Thank you.
All right, so how did this start for you, music?
Well, it started out when I was a little kid, and I heard Linda Ronstadt on the radio and television and Dolly Parton, and I thought, I want to be like them. So,
what did you hear from her? What songs then was she doing?
Well, it was the 80s tour, and I was really a small kid, and it was broadcasted on television, I remember.
Okay.
And I saw her singing, and it was a song called, let me think. I can't remember, but it was just something
about this.
A Fateless Love by G.D. Sutter.
Okay.
And that song and her voice, those two together, those made me think, I want to be like her.
This.
I want to sing like
her. What age were you? You're a small child?
Four. I think four or five.
Okay, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, that's starting early. Okay.
Yeah.
So I always
knew I wanted to be a singer, so.
Okay. So that took care of it.
It did.
Yeah, J.D. South, that's not a bad way to begin. All right, so how did you pursue this then?
Well, I just started rehearsing because I just loved music. I didn't know anything about the voice or something. So, and it's a muscle, so you need to train it.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, so I started singing. I didn't knew that by then, of course, but I just start singing and making music with my daddy. My daddy, he plays the guitar and he plays a lot of instruments.
Oh, so he's a musician. Okay.
Yeah, and I played with him and I practiced with him. And at the age of 10, I was on stage. So, yeah.
In what setting then? What would be a venue you could play at 10?
Yeah. Well,
Because a lot of people here started
fashion shows.
Fashion shows and stuff like
that. Sort
a lot of people here start in churches and stuff. They get in church choirs
yeah.
and all that kind of thing. You know,
well, we don't have
you
that.
See, you don't have that, right.
Not
yeah.
like here.
Here.
No,
it's a whole different religious expression and environment. But so many singers start out in gospel groups and church groups and all that. It
would
have
been great
yeah,
if I could
yeah.
start there. But, you know, we don't have that.
whole different deal in the Netherlands.
Yeah, it
okay.
is.
So fashion shows, whatever, where they'll hire a 10-year-old or let a 10-year-old play and sing.
Yeah.
So your dad could help there.
Yeah.
And so you did what kind of material then? What were the songs that you'd be doing?
Country.
Country song.
Yeah, I already did country song. And in Holland, I couldn't, when I grew up, I couldn't make a living with country then.
Okay.
So,
interesting.
Yeah, so I had to do some other stuff.
And so you started, let me stop.
Oh, I
had to
stop.
Yeah. Already.
So I had to do some other stuff to make a living.
In music,
yeah,
but you
I did
were
pop
in
music,
okay.
and yeah, I played in bands. But then I thought, well, I didn't like it anymore. So I thought, oh, I'm gonna quit, or I'm gonna do the thing that I love most in life, singing country. So and that's when I came back to Nashville and thought, well, I'm gonna do it one more time, just for me. For nobody else, just for me, the thing I really love. And I really wanted to quit singing just because I didn't like singing and performing anymore in the Netherlands because I couldn't make the music I love so much. So that was the deal.
So you were going to do what? Did you know?
I don't know.
Didn't really know.
No.
Well, I'm glad that didn't work out.
Me too.
Lana Wolf is with us, and she has been recording in Nashville. The Fireflies in Nashville is her latest. Her first album was simply called Nashville, right?
Yeah.
Lana Wolf Nashville. Paul Schultz has found that and put that on the screen as well. She's visiting with us here, and we're delighted to have her here. We're going to take this break. We come back. We'll set the next one. Lana Wolf is with us. She's visiting with us out of the Netherlands. Her CD is called Fireflies in Nashville. It was recorded. She recorded work at Studio 19. And Larry, what is Larry's studio now? What do they call it?
Studio 19.
And then
19, now at Sound Kitchen.
Sound Kitchen is where it is. And so Studio 19 relocated Sound Kitchen. And, of course, Larry's also involved with Jaxon Records here in Jackson, Tennessee. And he and Jimmy Exit will be with us coming up at the 8 o'clock hour today. But Lana Wolf is with us. She was out early anyway, had the jet lag, and we're pleased to have her with us. So you start then as a child. You hear Linda Ronstadt, and you want to sing, and your father works that out. And then you start doing rock and roll and whatever and
every kind of
pop music, just trying to make a living in this business in the Netherlands. Then decided that you wanted to do country.
Yeah.
Okay. And so when you made that decision, and you say there wasn't really a market for that much.
Not at all.
Okay.
Not at all. No.
Okay. Which is in contrast to some areas of Europe, right?
Germany, they really love
country music
still.
Okay.
And Norway, they do. Sweden, they do.
Yeah.
But Holland, it's all gone. Country was very big in the 80s in Holland, in the 70s and 80s.
Okay.
And then it just...
Huh.
It's gone.
Okay.
So it was very hot, and everybody told me, you're crazy doing this. And crazy because I'm doing a theater show also called The American Country Legends in Holland. And everybody told me, you're crazy doing this. And I said, no, I have to do this. It was just something.
So you put together a stage show.
Yeah, really.
Organized a stage show. Okay.
A theater show, yeah.
And so a theater show this theater show is music, talk, both?
Yeah, we're telling stories about all the things from the 40s until now. All kinds of music and how it developed, and it's cool because young people are coming in and coming to our shows now, so that's good. There are a lot of older people who still like country music, but it's also important to educate the younger people and let them see what a cool kind of music country music is.
All right, so you're putting together this stage show, and everybody's telling you that you're crazy for doing it.
Yeah.
All right, so how did you get people to come to the first show?
Just on Facebook, and I did a lot of promotion, just and being out there just with the guitar, just with a few members of the band, just telling everybody.
Okay.
So it was hard.
You playing on street corners? What are you doing out here?
No, not on street, but in cafes or
anywhere
bars.
You could go.
Everywhere I could tell it. And I had a radio show at that time where I promoted, I was a DJ for a while. And I promoted country music and West Coast music and everything, every blues, roots, everything that has something to do with the real music, because I think it doesn't matter what kind of music you make, as long as there's soul in it. Okay. It needs to have a soul, and I think this music has that power and this feeling for me.
So despite skepticism of everyone else, you organize and you got other people to work with you.
Yep.
How many people do you have in your cast the first show that you did?
We play with eight people on stage and a sound guy and a light guy.
Okay, so we got 10.
10 people.
We got a stage show.
Yeah.
We get out and you open. Opening night, what was it like?
Well, there were about 1,500 people.
1,500?
Yeah.
Not
and
a bad opening night.
No, and we did 4 of those big shows, so that was an amazing start. And, I started it easy. You know, 15 shows. I started with 15 shows. Next year, 15 shows. And this season, we're going to play 26 shows.
26 shows.
Yeah, I'm going to...
So you're touring this every year. Is it just in the Netherlands?
Yeah, just in Belgium now, and it's sold out before we even started the season. So, you know, something's happening in Holland again. And we have a lot of good country artists. People don't realize that, but we have some real good country artists in Holland too, you know. And it's good for the whole scene and for everybody in country music and who loves country music.
So you'll put this this show on the road then when?
Well, we're starting again in October, and I have to make a new show this time. So, and it's called A Night at the Opry, and that's a very, I'm so excited because Saturday night I'm going to be backstage at the Grand Ole Opry.
You're going to the Grand Ole Opry.
Oh, yeah, man, I'm so excited. I can tell you.
Okay.
Yeah, so I will be a special guest backstage.
Okay.
So, and I'm going to make a show about the Grand Ole Opry. I can't tell you how excited I am.
So Saturday night, you'll be backstage at the Grand Ole Opry, and your show is going to start touring in October.
Yep.
And it's called A Night at the Opry.
Yes.
So you've got a set then that's designed like the old Opry set at the Ryman one now? Or
it's going to be the old Red Barn.
Red Barn, okay.
With some differences, but that's the idea.
A little Martha White Flower sign, and here we go. Okay, well, that's terrific.
Yeah.
And you're going to be backstage at the Grand Ole Opry for the first time this Saturday.
Yeah.
I can tell you're excited. Lana Wolf is with us. She is from the Netherlands, and she's here, and she's promoting her music and her songs and all that. We're delighted to have her with us. And when we come back, we'll play I Love Being a 70s Child and more as we continue. Lana Wolf is with us. A real thrill to have her. She's excited about this music. That's what's interesting. I mean,
I love the music.
So 15 shows, first year, 15, second year. Now you're doing 26 shows this season.
In 3 months.
In 3 months in the Netherlands and in Belgium.
Yeah.
And Belgium sold out already.
Yeah. Cool, huh?
That's pretty good. Starting a tour with a sold out in advance is a nice...
Yeah.
that's got to be a nice feeling. Fireflies in Nashville is the name of her CD. And she is visiting with us, and we're delighted to have her here. It's her second time to record in Nashville, an album called Nashville that's available on vinyl, which is kind of exciting.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah. And so what made you do the vinyl?
Well, I collect vinyl.
Okay.
And especially the older ones, 60s, 70s stuff.
Yeah, okay.
And so I thought I need to have just one vinyl of
myself. Album of your own.
Yeah, on my own.
That's great stuff. But it's Lana Wolf Nashville, so... How do people get access to your music? How can they order it, get it?
Well, just on lanawolf.com.
Lanawolf.com. L-A-N-A-W-O-L-F, lanawolf.com. And so pick it up and
it's
get
on Spotify nowadays, people can listen on
Spotify
and iTunes.
So you can download and do all of that.
Sure.
So there it is. Fireflies in Nashville is the most recent. Lana's been talking to us about how she got in, if you just joined us. She got into music as a child, heard Linda Ronstadt and Dolly Parton on a television special.
Yeah.
Wanted to sing, started doing country. And then got into rock and roll and pop and all of that to make a living because there was not a market for country music in the Netherlands. She's from the Netherlands. And then decided, finally, that she didn't want to do that anymore. It was actually going to get, like, a regular job.
Yeah.
Didn't know what. Thought about getting out of music and then said, no, I'm going to put together a country show. And so she put together an 8-person country show to do a diversity of country songs and tell the stories of the music and all this other stuff from the 40s through the 90s or 2000, whatever. And first year they did 15 shows, had 1,500 people opening night, which is exciting. But now they're planning to do 26 shows this year. It's going to be called A Night at the Opry. They'll start touring it in the Netherlands and in Belgium. They've got 26 dates, and some of the shows already sold out.
Yeah.
That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, it is.
How do you pick the music then? You're going this, you got Night at the Opry, and so it's a blank slate. You can do anything you want.
Yeah.
So you're going to have this Opry-looking stage with a red barn.
Yeah.
And so you're going to come out and do what? How many people sing in your show? You sing and others sing?
Five people sing.
Five people sing.
Yeah,
okay.
And one of them is really a great bluegrass singer, but really a good one. It's our fiddler. And we got Pam Macbeth. She's from Nashville, so, and she sounds a little like Dolly, so that's okay. Nice.
She's blonde.
She's right. blonde and okay. has big boots.
Boots.
Yeah, boots. I said boots,
boots.
People.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've seen it.
Yeah. Okay. So, and then there's this guy, Wim, and he sounds a little like Vince Gill, so... Okay. He got some great skills, some great guitar skills,
so
too.
So you got these people, and so how do you put together? You know, you can do anything, right?
Yeah.
So the songs are...
Yeah, well, I always make a show that I like myself, but also for my audience. So I always think, what would they like to hear, and what can I show them that they don't know already? Because there's a lot of stuff that we don't know in Holland, because here it's big, or a hit, or artist that's really big.
Okay.
So, but there's going to be Uncle Pen. We're going to play Uncle Pen. Then some bluegrass stuff. We're going to do, of course, some Linda Ronstadt, Dolly Parton, some traditionals. Farther Along is a song, you know, it's a beautiful song. And, well, people know it's from, I think, the trio. They cut the song, but... people don't really know it, so there's so many good country songs with close harmony.
So then when you put this show together, part of this is an education process for this audience. You want to expose them to things they haven't heard.
Yeah,
there's
but
some
a,
risk
but a
in
fun.
That.
Yeah, but a fun part.
Okay.
And I mix it up with Johnny Cash, the stuff they know back in Holland, Kenny Rogers, because everybody loves Kenny Rogers in Holland. Yeah, so I mix it up with those kind of songs, and then the songs they... don't really know or hurts
the
somewhere.
Show lasts how long?
55 minutes.
55 minutes?
Yeah.
And so you want to build this thing up to a crescendo and have them wanting more. Okay.
Yeah.
So it's a 1 hour show.
Two times 55 minutes.
Okay. All right,
yeah.
So 2 55 minutes. We got an intermission, come back and do it again.
Yep.
Okay. So 2 hour show. And you try to build it up, and then, like I said, have them in the aisle and want more.
Yeah,
okay.
That's what we do.
And been doing it for a long time, doing it successfully. Does country get radio play in the Netherlands?
Well, not really. And, you know, it's a miracle that my single has been played on national radio in Holland, because it's for the first time in a long time that there's country on the radio again. And we have a few artists that sometimes come through, but then they go back to the pop music. So they don't stay on country because it doesn't sell that well.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it is. But we have, I think, 6 or 7 great artists, great country artists in Holland. But nobody sticks to country because radio, they won't play it. So that's a problem.
Is it state radio there? Or is
state radio and commercial.
And
we have both.
But they just don't play country music.
Not really.
You still have a radio show?
No, I don't have time for that. I had to choose. No, but that's the thing.
Okay.
I like so many things. So
can't do it all.
No.
I keep trying, but it doesn't work. You break. Now something gets neglected.
Try
out
singing,
there.
Steve. Oh.
I sing a lot, just nobody hears it.
You know, okay.
That's the way that works. 7:31 the time. Lana Wolf is with us. She's from the Netherlands. And so this song, you say, is one of your favorites.
Yeah.
This. And this song is called Dream...
Dream Chaser.
Dream Chaser. Tell me about this song.
Well, I was in Nashville, and I saw a girl behind the bar, and she was working, and she was singing every song that the band played. And I came up to her, and I asked her, well, what do you do? She said, I'm a waiter, but actually I'm a singer like everybody.
Right,
but everybody's so good. And, you know, I felt sorry for her, but at the same time, it's my story too, because I'm always pushing, never pulling, always pushing. And that's the thing. And I thought I had to write a song about this. So this song is about
this
that.
This song, the Dream Chaser. This is Lana Wolf. Everybody can everybody can be happy and you can get together for dinner and all that stuff. 868-1700. Billy Duke and her staff have a great hotel. They welcome you here in Jackson, and we're pleased. And you've stayed there in this wonderful place, didn't
it? It's wonderful. Yeah. Big rooms.
Yeah.
Good just, television.
Yeah, it's just
good
just,
shower, because that's important. That's the most important thing in a hotel. Better than breakfast.
Everybody's got a different perspective. I go down for the food.
Oh,
I can
really?
I can take a bath anywhere, but I need to eat right now. But anyway, but Billy, they have a great hotel here, and it's conveniently located to Jackson, Tennessee, and we appreciate them working with us. 868-1700. So the next time you got folks coming in, or you want to do your own weekend getaway, and you got a pool, a hot tub, place to stay, got food, and you know somebody else to clean up, that's a wonderful break to spend a weekend right here in town at the Comfort Suites in Jackson, Tennessee. We appreciate them working with us. Lana Wolf is with us. Got into this music as a child. Heard Dolly Parton and Linda Ronstadt on a television special. Wanted to do country music. Did it as a child and then as an adult to make a living in music in Holland. Started doing pop and rock and all that stuff, and finally just said, if that's what I'm going to do, I'm going to get out of this. And she put together a country show. It sells out. She's doing 26 dates starting in October. And it's a full theater type show, a two-hour show, 55-minute segments. And they're built to 26 dates in the Netherlands and in Belgium. So this young lady is a star in the Hollands and doing it in a tough way, because you say the country music scene is just limited there.
Yeah, limited.
Radio plays limited. But they are playing. They're playing Love Being a 70s Child.
They do they on are national radio.
On
so
national radio, okay.
Yeah, but it's just...
How did you go about pitching that? Did you know someone there to pitch it to?
Yeah,
okay.
I knew somebody who really loves music, and that's important. And I knew him, and I let him listen to the song, and he said, "Whoa, this is good. This is good." And he never likes anything I do. So
so it's like, okay,
so
got a
I
breakthrough.
Thought, oh well, that's nice. So and he started playing it on national radio, Radio okay. 2 in Holland.
Is part of this in being here, do you want to build a fan base then outside of Holland, beyond Holland? I mean,
Well, I don't think small. I think big, and
okay.
Maybe it's stupid. I don't know, but I always think, well, we got the world. I don't have my own because I'm already playing and touring in my country, and with the internet and all these things and all the connections I have. I think it's possible to play everywhere
okay.
around the world. And I'm
would you want to take that show to... Would that show work in the States?
I think so.
Okay.
I think so, because I was talking to some people, and they were telling me this might work here too. So it's... I think it might work. So maybe I will bring them over next time.
Okay. Well, it would be interesting to see. Because the show is not just music. It's explanation. It talks about the songs and people and the stories and writing.
Yeah.
So it kind of weaves this. It's kind of a theatrical type production with music to tell this and expose people to this music. You say the artists there with which they're familiar would be like Johnny Cash.
Yeah.
The songs that people know, you say Kenny Rogers.
Kenny Rogers. Patsy Cline.
Okay.
Rascal Flatts. All those.
Those things, okay.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, we play all types of songs, you know, everything that has roots, maybe a little bit blues, Bonnie Raitt, just the Americana country. So we want to show people how big country music is. And so there are so many variations to country music. So we want to show that to the people.
When you do Uncle Penn and stuff like that.
Yeah. It's hard, but, you know, we have a very good guitar player and a fair.
Bluegrass looks simple, but it's not. It ain't.
No, but our fiddler, and he plays the mandolin.
People react to it? Do they like it?
Well, we're going to do it.
Okay, so you don't
we
know
We start
yet.
Rehearsing. We don't know yet, but I know my guys, and I know they can pull
play it.
They
okay.
can pull this off.
Right.
No problem.
Is that
yeah. going to
open the show?
No, I'm going to open with the Dixie Chicks.
Okay. You can do that there better than you can here.
I know. I've heard what they've done. I don't get those girls, you know, but I'm a big fan of their music.
Okay, yeah.
I really am.
Obviously, a lot of people were. I mean, they were a hugely successful group.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes,
I know.
You know, every once in a while, you can overload yourself.
I know. It isn't smart.
So sometimes you move into an area where you say, we didn't have to say that, but
no.
I've done that a time or two in my life.
Oh, well.
You know, it happens to us all.
You're still here.
I'm still here. Well, you know, sometimes you have to move.
Sometimes
you have to move.
Yeah, that's true.
But start over. And so I've done that a time. time or two. So you're going to start off with the Dixie Chicks.
Yeah.
You're going to work in the Uncle Penn. On the, when you're playing something with which people are an artist that, with which people are not as familiar, do you introduce that then? You tell them?
Yeah, because once people get to know the story behind the artist or behind the song, they will listen more carefully. Okay. And because in Holland, we all speak English, but not like you. We don't, the people don't get the lyrics right away. So once you tell, they have to really get into it and listen to it. And once you have explained it to them, it's easier for them to get it. And they will get more into the song.
So there are things that are said in songs that we understand that they would not as easily, because they speak a precise English.
Yeah, because sometimes you have sayings that we don't know.
No, yeah. Well, there was an example last night we were having a conversation. It was like, and you were going, I forget what the word was. It was like, wait a minute, what are y'all talking about? About what are you speaking?
Yeah.
Right. Are you writing all these songs?
Yeah, I wrote most of these songs. Two, I didn't. So the next song you're going to play, I didn't write this one.
Do you write with other people? You do it also?
I do. I do a lot of co-writing. Sometimes I write alone, but I like co-writing because I like the way of getting in. Well, two minds know more and make more beautiful things sometimes than one person, I
think. Peter Montgomery was with us last week, and he said about co-writing. He said, well, you can try to carry a couch by yourself, but sometimes it pays to have help.
Yeah.
But so two people can lift a couch and move it easier than one. And he said that's what he had found in songwriting many times, that it was the
because
the two
you got another angle to go on.
Yeah. In writing, English is not your base language.
No.
So you're writing, but you're writing in English.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. So
okay.
Yeah, so that's different.
Do the thoughts come to you in your native language and then you transfer them sometimes?
Well, sometimes and sometimes not, because some sayings in English are easier. They, even for us, some words are easier to, so sometimes it comes in English and sometimes it just comes in Dutch, and I have a story and then I will translate it, and I will check with my American friends, of course, before I will
write it down to make sure that I'm,
sometimes I mess up still. Yeah.
So the thoughts can originate in Dutch and then transfer to English. Sometimes the thoughts originate in English.
Yeah. Well, it depends on how long you are here, because now I'm too short here to think English, but when I'm here maybe 2 weeks, I will start thinking in English, I will start dreaming in English, so that's really strange.
Interesting.
Yeah, it is.
But you write these songs are written in English, they're not written in Dutch. You write in English.
I write with Americans, mostly. Yeah, so they won't understand me.
Lana Wolf is with us. That's, you know, because, you know, most of us just know English. That's, you know, that's all we, you know, you have to beat us to study a foreign language or force us to at school.
Yeah.
And so it's not something we do comfortably now. We don't feel that we have to.
Well, you don't, because...
Yeah, we're arrogant.
I know.
Like, well, everybody, if you don't speak English, you should.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, okay.
Well, my friend, for example, Pam, she lives in Holland for about 10 years now, but everybody speaks English to her.
Still.
Still. So
she's never had to learn Dutch.
No, not really. So she's still speaking, and we're all speaking English to her, so American. Yeah, so...
Okay.
Yeah, that's funny, yeah?
She's lived there 10 years, has not learned Dutch.
A few words.
Get out of my way.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's important.
So people talk to her in English. Because most people then in Holland speak both.
Yeah. And speak German, French. So
one time I went to Saudi Arabia and all the signs were dual, Arabic and then English.
Yeah.
And I thought, wow, interesting. Yeah. So many people could communicate with us. You know, we couldn't communicate with them, but they could with us.
And that's also why you don't have to stick to your own country, you know. Once you get the language, you can be everywhere.
Anywhere.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I may travel all the way down to Saltillo.
Oh, you come to Holland. You're famous in Holland.
We did a television interview, Studio 6, with E+TV6, and Solana has been posting. And so she says that if I come to Holland, if I get off the plane, there will be people that will know me.
Yeah.
I've been on TV. been on the internet over there, and this interview has had thousands of views.
Yeah,
thousands of views. Okay, so if I overload myself here and have to have another place to go work, I'm gonna come see you.
You will come to Holland.
All right, come to Holland. If people can speak English to me, then I can make it. Lana Wolf is with us. Tell us about this song.
Well, I did. This is one of the songs I didn't write. It's a song of Mick Lee and Alan Glass, and it's called Sunshine and Love. And I thought, after all the the sad songs, we need a happy song. So here it is.
We need a happy song on this CD.
Yeah, we do.
Lana Wolf is with us. She's got copies of this CD. She'll sign those for you while she's here. She'll be here another hour. And Larry Rogers, we're going to talk to him, Jimmy X, some other folks coming up in this next hour. We're glad to have you with us. This hour, by the way, Blue Suede Forever has been brought to you by Steel Storm Shelters. The next big one will hit. And the tornadoes, you were interested in tornadoes. They had some in Birmingham, you'll think, because you don't have those.
No, not like these.
Not like
these. No, just little small ones.
She didn't want to be in a tornado. She wanted to chase one.
I wanted to chase one, really.
You know, the next big one will hit. We just don't know where. You can protect your family. Go to steelstormshelters.com. Check that out. Then make the call and go to work with them. But this is, once again, this song is called Sunshine and Love. It's one of the happy songs from Fireflies in Nashville with Lana Wolf, our guest at Blue Suede Forever. Country Store, Casey Jones Village on WDXI AM and FM here in Jackson, Tennessee. Lana Wolf is with us. She's been with us this last hour. An absolute delight to have her in the States. She's here to promote her Fireflies in Nashville CD that was recorded with Larry Rogers and all the folks in Nashville. Who all were the musicians with whom you worked on this?
Michael Baker on guitar. Okay. Rory on drums. The real session.
Okay, the session
real,
guys
yeah,
out of Nashville.
Yeah, the real good
session
guys.
So when you come in and you've written these songs.
Yeah.
And then you turn it over to these guys.
Yeah.
Okay, and they sit around and they do whatever they do, and then and here we go.
Yeah,
okay.
That's what happens here. That's the beauty of Nashville. We all play as a band, and they're mostly one takers. So I didn't.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
So I didn't do too much on it. So I sang with the band, and well, they start practicing one time, and then the recording button gets hit, and then
they start playing. They play.
And,
yeah. Well, they kind of look at each other. The times I've been up there, they kind of look at each other and say, are we ready? And it's like, we got this. And so here we go. And it's wham.
It's amazing.
Amazing stuff.
When
you hear that, then I guess that brings out, I mean, you've written the song, you've done acoustic guitar, and then suddenly they get a hold of it, and it's like, ooh, here we go.
Yeah. Well, that's the feeling I can't explain to anybody, because you have to experience that feeling, and it only happened here in Tennessee. When you're here, the musicians, they breathe music, they live music, it's in their veins, it's everywhere. And that's the, and not that we don't have great musicians in Holland, because we do, but it's different. And, you know, sometimes I think I was born on the wrong side of the ocean, really, because I'm always so happy when I'm here and I hear all those bands and those artists singing on stage, and they're so talented, and it's just the right feel. It's all about the timing and the feel and that sort of stuff.
Okay. There is something here, and it goes, and we've talked about this some. The European experience is a very different experience, and the church experience is very different.
Mm-hmm.
And here, we talked about it, like we say with the show, that from New Orleans to Muscle Shoals to Memphis to Nashville and Bristol, all the pop music of the world comes from here, and it does, and there's something. I don't know what it is. It's in that culture, that mix of black and white we have, that rural poverty we have, all these things that bred this music. And it's in us in a way that it's not sometimes other places. I mean, they're technical, great musicians, but as you say, obviously.
No, but it's the feel.
It has to
come from inside, from your heart. And that's something you cannot learn. No, but that's really true. You got to feel that, or you got to love the music so much.
Yeah. When you get around those guys in Nashville, you go, this
is
it. Okay.
That's what happens.
Wow.
And it makes me so happy.
Lana Wolf is here. Now you know why. She's going to be backstage at the Grand Ole Opry for the first time in her life. Her show is going to be touring in the Netherlands and Belgium. They're going to do 26 shows, a night at the Opry, a theatrical-type presentation of two 55-minute segments that'll cover country music from the 40s to the whatever, and already selling out some of the dates, and so it's real, real good to have her here. She's going to be with us for a few more minutes. If you got time to stop by here on the way to work or whatever, Fireflies in Nashville, she'll sign copies of that. Tell me about this song. This is kind of a bluesy song, you say?
Yeah, it's a bluesy song, and it's about my husband, how we met.
Oh, how you met. No wonder you got the blues.
Yeah, no.
If Pam was going to write one about me, that would be it. You know.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, One in a Million Man, and how did I, subtitle, How Did I Wind Up With Him?
Well, no, but without him, I couldn't have done all this.
So he's been supportive of this.
Oh, so very much. And he always say, well, do you need to go? Go. just pack your stuff, go. Oh, or maybe he wants to get rid of me. I don't know, but okay. That's another option.
So no wonder. So he is a one in a million guy. Yeah. What's his name?
Jaxon.
Yes, that's exactly what I thought.
Yeah.
How do you spell that?
Jaxon. Jaxon.
Jaxon.
Yeah.
Well, it's a good thing he didn't come with you.
No.
We had a hard enough time with Lana, you know, because we want to say Lana,
yeah,
Lana,
whatever.
Lana Wolf is with us.
Yeah, I'm happy with every day.
Whatever it is.
Yeah.
Lana Wolf. It's a real pleasure. Thank you so much
for doing this.
Steve, I appreciate this. And I feel confident we'll get to do this again. She's an extraordinary artist, committed to this work, and has found a place. And hope you find a place here. I'd be interesting to see this if this show come to the United States. Or you come over here and put one together over here and put it
maybe
on the road.
Maybe I will.
Put it on the road. This is talking about her husband, a one in a million man. This is Lana Wolf. Oh, I better get things plugged up. Yeah, I better plug up something on this side here. I have to switch my gears here. Which I forgot to do. There we go. Rogers is with us, and Jimmy Exum with us, and they are partners at Jaxon Records here in Jackson, Tennessee. First of all, Lana is going to be doing work at Jaxon Records today. What's going to be happening there?
We're going to record one song when she got into Nashville. She said, I have one song I'd like to do. So I said, well, we're going to Jaxon. So I said, what's the song? She said, Hank Williams song. I'm so lonesome I could cry.
Did you tell her somebody already done that?
And I said, so the next morning, I was walking through the house, and she had my guitar. I said, let me hear a little of that I'm so lonesome I could cry. Whew.
Is that right?
Oh my gosh!
Okay,
she can really sing it. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you've heard plenty. So if it touches you, then
yes.
Okay.
And there's not a lot of country music over there, so it's kind of amazing that she knows that song.
Yeah.
You would think there would be country music in Holland.
I was just stunned knowing that, you know, all the people we have from here that go to Sweden and Germany and England and they play a lot and that you've got that pocket. And she said it's just not there. But that the show she's put together is working very well. And so she brings something unique to this song.
She does.
Okay. So you will record her with an acoustic guitar here. Then what will you do with that?
Well, either we're going to finish it in Nashville, finish it here, or let her take it back to the Netherlands and finish it. We haven't decided.
Okay.
We're going to do one of the three.
Okay. Well, I'll be interested in hearing this.
It will.
If it's
so stop by today if you like.
Okay, all right. So if it piqued your interest, then that's...